off your leg.
I know you're frightened, mate, okay? You need to let us help you, okay?
This is Heath. He actually tried to physically hop out of the truck while he was still trapped.
This is a really critical situation. He's got really nasty leg injuries. Is he going to bleed to death? That's what I'm thinking.
Open your eyes, mate. Squeeze my fingers.
Oh! Listen, you need to stop moving.
Would you rescue me when I'm by myself? When I need your love, if I need your help, would you rescue me? Would you rescue me? But
very worried for you, my friend.
The bone's been smashed to bits.
Whoa!
He's actually stopped breathing.
We are.
Without intervention, he's quite likely to die.
Better?
It's really good. I needed to come back, I think. My mental health. I need the balance.
The Royal Melbourne Hospital's emergency department is always on the go. But sometimes the team can relax and take five.
That's safe.
Oh, look at her little face.
That was on her birthday. Feels good to be back. I needed to come back to find my balance, though. I am my best self when I find a bit of balance.
It doesn't take long before Nurse Sarah's next patient is on the way.
Royal Melbourne, receive in. Go ahead.
Good afternoon, Royal Melbourne. We've got a 35-year-old male truck driver who's got an incomplete amputation of his left leg.
Director of Emergency, Dr. Mark Putland, is in charge of the flow of patients today.
We're just checking how far away you are from here. What's your ETA?
Yeah, traffic's pretty heavy, 25 to 30 minutes.
So we have a young man who's crashed his truck. There's serious injuries to his lower limbs. We're clearly going to have a very confronting scene when he arrives. There'll be a lot of pain, but there'll be a lot of fear as well.
Preparing for life-threatening injuries, Deputy Director of Emergency, Dr. Nicola Walsham, rounds up the troops.
Trauma. All right, so we'll gather our team and then we'll do our briefing.
Two tourniquets ready to go.
We've got a line ready to go.
Yep.
Yeah.
Okay.
There are people who arrive at hospital with really a few minutes to live or die, depending on what we do.
All right, shall we check together?
Yep.
Okay, we've got an O positive.
We want reasonably large number of things done very quickly in the first 5 to 10 minutes.
Terrific.
The critically injured tow truck driver has just survived a terrifying ordeal. The 39-year-old is in excruciating pain, with his leg almost sliced off.
Hello.
Hello. I'm Jane.
Any immediate life threats?
That's the cabin. It's gone through his legs there.
It's eye-watering?
Yeah.
Mm. He's had a really prolonged period of entrapment in the truck because of the machinery being crushed around him. The injuries to his leg are clearly horrific.
Hello, you from anaesthetics? Yeah, wonderful. If you can take over, that'd be great.
Okay, let's make this nice and smooth.
One, two, three.
He's clearly extremely distressed. The good thing that we're seeing is that he's awake and he's screaming in pain. Now, that's a terrible sounding thing to say, but it means that we know his brain is intact.
This is Heath, lives at home with his wife, independent with ADLs, no past medical history, no allergies.
Heath's partner, Nicole, is rushing in to be with him.
You're OK, mate. We're going to look after you, OK? I know you're in pain. Lots of people around you. It's OK. Everyone's here to look after you, OK? I know.
On our arrival, complaining of extreme pain, he actually tried to physically hop out of the truck while he was still trapped.
Oh, my legs are...
We're just trying to...
I can't feel your legs!
Heath, I know you're frightened, mate, OK? You need to let us help you, OK?
Open your eyes, mate. Squeeze my fingers.
Before they can even take a look at Heath's mangled legs, they need to get his pain under control.
Give me some stronger painkillers.
Yes!
Heath is extremely agitated. He's in a lot of pain. He's frightened. We just need to calm him down and gain some control over the situation.
Listen, you need to stop moving.
shoal outside large Croatian port.
Emergency doctor Andrew Trezise is a problem solver.
Well, it is a cryptic one. I do like doing the crossword. It begins with an L. Can be a very challenging job, so to do something that's completely different is quite a nice little break. It's quite a satisfying thing when you get it right. Not that I get it right very often.
It's a storeroom.
Thank you.
Dr. Andrew's break is cut short by news of a critically injured patient coming in by air ambulance from country Victoria.
G'day, Royal Melbourne. We've got a cyclist that's been involved in an accident with a motor vehicle.
He's been struck by a moving van. My biggest concerns are going to be, is there a significant head injury? Broken ribs, punctured lungs, they're all basically life-threatening injuries that you can get from an impact like this. Neck injuries can actually be lethal.
You can always jump on airway if we need to.
Yeah, but,
hopefully we won't need to.
Dr. Andrew is gathering his team as the chopper arrives, bringing in 53-year-old cyclist John. The retail worker was riding home from work when he collided with a van.
It's a bumpy old helipad, okay? Whereabouts were you from the hospital? Were you near the hospital?
I was in compartments.
Oh, dear? Okay, yeah.
So have you done a brief for the team?
We did a quick brief.
He's here.
Oh, he's here.
Good afternoon, sir.
Andrew's team leader.
Hello, hi.
Toby.
Hi.
The patient is John.
John. Hi, John.
Assisting Dr. Andrew is emergency doctor Emma West.
Do you want X-ray to do a chest X-ray?
I think I would do chest and pelvis, yeah, in this guy.
I always enjoy working with Emma. Emma's extremely experienced. Having somebody there who's able to step in just in case everything gets a little bit out of control is quite reassuring.
On the count of three, all the way. One, two, three. Well done, mate. Right, we're just gonna, is it okay if we cut your top off, mate, just so we can assess you?
Yeah, can you open up your mouth for me? Any pain on a chest wall as I'm pressing there?
So this is John. He was riding his push bike today in Warrigal in Gippsland.
Yep.
Wearing a helmet.
I'm just going to pop another needle in so we can do some blood tests.
Head, wearing the helmet, has struck the windscreen and caused an enormous indent in the windscreen, so pushing it in with a large spiderweb pattern. He's actually pretty lucky considering. So injuries, I think, would probably be neck, possible right-sided rib.
Is your shoulder sore?
Yeah, well, not the shoulder, but you call it these...
Collarbones.
Yeah.
Yeah, okay.
Deep breath in, real fast, my friends. Good.
The team quickly scan for anything that could be immediately life-threatening.
Deep breath in again. Good.
The ultrasound doesn't show a significant injury, which is great. There's no bleeding internally, and we can't detect a pneumothorax.
The damage to John's bike helmet reveals how hard his head hit the van.
So it's done its job.
Yeah.
But it's going a bit now.
Ooh, yeah, definitely.
That's good. What's hurting at the moment for you?
Sort of neck and just shoulders are just...
Both shoulders?
Yeah, stiff on the neck.
The neck pain is worrying. Neck injuries can be life-threatening. We need to find out what's going on pretty quick.
Dr. Andrew and Dr. Emma are treating a 53-year-old cyclist who smashed into a van on his way home from work.
We'll just start off with some fentanyl boluses, maybe 25 of fentanyl.
John lives more than 100 kilometres from the hospital, so his son can't be with him.
Can you tell me what happened?
Yeah, I was just heading from the cycle track, crossing the road to get on the other side cycle track. And, just a car. Just trying to get between cars.
The other side.
Just mistimed it, and then I hit the van.
John's able to interact with me, so it says that his brain is computing well, and that's a good sign for him. But we also know he's hit that windscreen at very high speed, so the risks aren't all gone.
But it sounds like primary, no acute concerns at the moment, and nothing particularly on the secondary, really, except maybe some chest wall tenderness. And observation's all stable, so we'll get the bloods off, and then we should get a portable chest and pelvis.
I'm just going to hold your head nice and straight.
To protect his neck, the team quickly get him into a hard collar.
Slightly less comfortable, I'll say, but better just until we know that you don't have any injuries. Is this wrist sore at all?
So, we're just here to do some x-ray, so okay?
X-ray.
So at this point with John, we've done the basic stuff, we've done the ultrasounds and the x-rays, and at the moment we're happy he's stable.
So you stay nice and still like a board. And we're ready to roll on three. One, two, three.
All right, mate. Any pain? Yes or no?
Yeah, my neck.
Neck.
Just in the neck?
Yep.
Pain where I'm pressing there?
No.
Any pain here?
From his neck downwards, seems all right. But the fact that he's actually in quite a lot of pain is worrying me a lot.
So we're going to get those scans done shortly. So we're going to scan from your head down to your pelvis, see if we can find any injuries. We've definitely sort of excluded immediate life-threatening injuries, which is good, but there can be lots of hidden stuff, so we still need to scan him from head to pelvis.
Having hit the windscreen with such force, John could have multiple injuries.
You're covered in blood. Mm. Well, we just wait for the scan and I'll just clean you up a bit.
I've been an emergency nurse for 25 years, and you have to be capable in managing a person's worst day of their life. If you can offer help and be giving, there's an unbelievable level of personal reward that you can gain from that.
Better? That's all right.
Nurse Eliza has managed to track down John's 17-year-old son, Jack.
Do you want to talk to him? Okay, hang on. Here he is.
Despite his alarming situation, John's careful not to worry his young son.
Hey, Jack, yeah, I'm all good, mate. Don't you worry, all right? No, my head's fine. It's, I just got, like, a bit of neck pain, a bit of, like, sort of whiplash happening sort of pain. All right, take care. See ya.
Is he all right?
Yeah.
Yeah, drink of water.
To make sure he won't be in pain during the CT scan, Nurse Eliza gives him some medication.
Oh. Does it hurt to swallow?
Where? Back of my head.
Oh, the back of the head. Okay.
When I give him the tablets, he grimaces so badly. It makes me think something's wrong.
Not your neck.
Very taut.
Oh. It's a bit of a red flag for me, because any severe pain in the neck, whether it's the back or the front, is not a good sign. I'm beginning to think that he's broken his neck.
You
can't have any water at the moment, bud, because you've been in an accident and we need to make sure you're okay.
Oh, fucking drinking water.
Dr. Nicola and the team are struggling to control 39-year-old Heath's pain. After his leg was nearly severed in a crash.
Okay, can I just need someone to hold his hand while I give a little bit of ketamine?
Listen, we're trying to help you. Just keep still, okay? Just keep still, mate. Don't move. Please don't move. I know. You can, because you have to, okay? So just breathe.
He's had the strongest pain relief that we have available to us, which is ketamine. He is in insurmountable amounts of pain. It's really difficult. He's really scared.
All right, so let's try and get the pain under control.
With Heath still in agony, Dr. Nicola decides on another course of action.
What do you think about intubating him?
I think for situational control, we might need to do it.
Humanitarian reasons as well.
Yeah, yeah.
Have a bit more control, yeah.
He's in a lot of pain at the moment, so sometimes it's just better to put him in what we call an induced coma and put him to sleep.
Before they can put the breathing tube in, they need to make sure his lungs are okay.
X-ray. We're good.
With the all clear to intubate, Dr. Nicola calls on the experience of emergency doctor Jonathan Papson.
How you going there, buddy?
He's pretty ketaminised.
So it's a really serious thing to intubate someone. It's not undertaken lightly. He won't feel anything, but he also won't breathe, won't protect his airway. And within 2 minutes of us giving him the drug, unless we get the breathing tube in, he could be dead as a result of the medicine we've just given him. But we need to do it for Heath.
We're going to go for 70 of ketamine, 150 of brocuronium. We've got aramine in case we need it, but we'll also give blood.
Ready?
Okay, let's go.
Let's do it. Drugs are going in. So that's 70 of ketamine. How's that?
Lovely. You got the tube, Sarah?
Yep.
And fentanyl, thanks. He's intubated now. J-Pap, there's some fentanyl for you if you want some more.
Thank you. Just 50 of fentanyl as well.
So the tube's fogging, you've got in tidal. Just try and bring the blood pressure down a bit. Probably need some propofol to bring the blood pressure down.
Yep. Propofol is here.
Great.
Got a good femoral pulse.
Blood pressure's fine.
Good job.
Heath's partner, Nicole, is anxiously waiting to see him.
They called me up and said, you know, he's been in an accident. We don't know if he's all right. He's had leg trauma. So you don't know what's going on. You don't know if they're alive, if they're dead.
Do you think we can let in the other teams now?
With Heath now sedated, they can see if his mangled leg can be saved.
From plastics team, hello, how are you? Vascular, come on in. We thought we'd open it all up together with all three teams.
And do we have analgesia and sedation running? Yeah, can I give you...
All right, should we take this down? This one first? I'll leave that up for a second to have a look.
It's a mess. He's got a mangled limb. If you picked up his leg, his foot may actually stay on the table.
I think we need to get him through the scanner. He might have to go to theatre for this.
Tow truck driver Heath has survived a horrific accident that may cost him his leg.
Are you happy that we start having a look at the lower limbs?
Because of his extreme pain, Heath's been intubated. The team can now get their first look at his injuries and see if his leg can be saved.
This one first, have a look. So this they described as penetrating from the bit of the cabin. What do we want to do with this?
Strictly speaking, from a vascular point of view, probably need the CT.
I'm going to slowly take the tourniquet down. We're just getting some packs ready.
This is a tricky moment for the team, taking off the tourniquet. Ideally, we take this tourniquet off in the operating theatre, because that's a safe place where we can fix any problems that might occur. We're all a bit uncomfortable that he's going to bleed more, but we need to have a look.
Maybe it's worth just getting the other unit and having it ready to go, just in case.
Yeah. Are you ready for me to put it, take it down?
Yep.
Okay.
So you're undoing the tourniquet now?
I'm undoing the tourniquet.
Yeah.
Tourniquet's down.
All right, well, it's not hosing.
We take the tourniquet down. He doesn't hose blood. He's just got brisk bleeding, which will be from veins or a damaged artery. Is he bleeding somewhere else? I don't know. The CT's going to tell us, hopefully.
What's his BP here? Saggy a bit. Do you want to just pump up the little bit damp to that trace? Yeah.
With the tourniquet off, the team worked to stabilise Heath's leg before going into the scanner.
So, ready to reduce and put the slab on?
Yep, go for it. The tourniquet's down. We're going to need just another dressing, actually, on that, I think. Thank you. He's ready to roll. You lot ready to roll?
Once we've got the yellow
bag, happy, Sarah?
Ready to go.
Yeah, I'm happy. Yep.
Gent was the plan.
Anything else we haven't done?
Thank you very much.
You better go, Dr. Walsham.
I'm going to go.
Thank you.
I'm going to go and hand over.
Yeah.
Dr. Jonathan and the team prepare to take Heath to the scanner.
Got one more pack cell here.
Okay.
And we've ordered another one.
Good. Let's face it, he's pretty unstable. I don't want him to bleed out in CT. So I've got the blood ready. It's a little bit risky going to CT, but CT's going to give us more information to help him.
Let's roll to CT and we'll continue to transfuse on the way. So we've got the yellow bag, red bag, EDA, antibiotics, ADT,
ventilator.
Sedation, ventilator. And so having got all that, I thought we can go to CT.
...53-year-old cyclist John is being scanned for neck and spine injuries after colliding with a van. The team is worried. He has a lot of pain in his neck.
I'm just going to start the scan now. Keep really still.
OK, well, this is his... this is his neck. Oh, my gosh. Oh. Oh, no. That's very badly broken. He's lucky he can still move his legs and arms.
I'm quite shocked because I can see that the vertebrae are in pieces. It's not a crack. They're in a number of pieces.
Oh, yeah, he's lucky to be alive and not completely paralysed.
With such a devastating scan result, Nurse Eliza keeps a closer check on John's condition.
You've got more pain now?
Yeah, I'm really uncomfortable.
Where?
Shoulders and...
Shoulders?
Neck and head.
Okay.
Dr. Andrew now has John's full scan report.
So far, oh, that's quite... Yeah, wow, that's pretty abnormal.
I'm pretty shocked by this that I'm seeing, really. This is a catastrophic injury. To be honest, he's extremely lucky he's made it to hospital even. He's got a fracture really, really high up in the neck. There's this sort of peg that sticks out of one of the vertebrae and then the other vertebra sits on top of it. And it's basically what allows you to turn your head from side to side. And he's snapped this basically clean off. The spinal cord is running right through the middle here. So if those two move sideways, his spinal cord's basically cut at that level. And that would be a lethal injury. That would certainly result in John dying. So I'm going to have to try and express that to him.
To be honest, I'm not surprised you're hurting in your neck because we've just looked at the scans and there's actually a fracture in the neck. Yeah. The bone is broken. It is a very unstable fracture. You can actually die from that injury. Okay. And it will mean obviously staying in hospital. And that could be for some time.
It's not the news you want to hear, but it's what it is.
Still nothing to eat or drink for now. Okay, just in case they need to do any surgery tonight.
It's tough to know whether he ever will get back to normal. These kind of injuries can be life-changing. At the very least, he's going to have chronic neck pain. He might have reduced movement in the neck. I think he's stable enough just to be able to go to a normal ward. From here, he's going to need lots of attention from orthopedics to look at his neck. He's going to need the trauma doctors to look at other injuries. They're going to need to sort out how they're going to fix all of these broken bones.
All right, good man. I'll see you later.
Deputy Director of Emergency, Dr. Steve Pinkus, is back after taking a break from life on the front line.
Hey, Connie. How you going? You alright? Yeah, not bad, not bad.
Deputy, where you been?
I had 3 weeks' leave.
Hey!
I've never taken long service leave, so I figured, bugger it, I'm going to take a month of long service leave while the weather's still enough. Oh, wouldn't have known. Clue, but I've been here for almost 30 years.
What keeps me working in emergency medicine after all this time is that I can see something every day that is different, interesting, exciting, and even sometimes surprising.
17-year-old Tian, or Tom as he's known, has dislocated his jaw and has been brought in by his worried mum Mei Ling and brother Morgan.
So I just received a phone call from Tom's teacher. Basically, he yelled, and it's all of a sudden, he cannot close his mouth.
Unable to speak, Tom's been talking by text.
Oh, I feel a little worried, but everything will go fine. Oh my God, year 12, first day at school.
Goodness.
Very unusual.
Emergency registrar Dr. Michael Conboy arrives to help the teenager.
Hello. Has this happened to you before?
No, OK. We'll be getting the jaw back in shortly.
Tom's jaw's been out for 5 hours. He's got a lot of swelling and a lot of pain. The longer it's out, the worse it gets, but it's quite a tricky procedure. There's very much a knack to it.
It's not straight down. It's sort of that rotatory...
Yeah, like kind of rotating around, yeah.
And it's like levering.
Cool.
Dr. Michael hasn't had a lot of experience relocating jaws, so Dr. Steve will mentor him.
I'll come there with you. How do you do it?
So, yawning.
Yeah, that's usually how you do it.
Yep.
Side top drawer. There it is.
Yeah, there we go.
Unwrap it and wrap it into a ribbon.
Kind of like that.
And then fold it in half and then wrap it around your thumb. Otherwise, you end up with really sore thumbs from pushing on their teeth.
Yeah.
It's like any mechanical job. You learn by doing. I can show him, but I want Michael to do this himself.
OK, my friend, spin yourself round and rest back. That's it. Tall, aren't you?
All right, I'm just going to put my thumbs inside your mouth on your teeth. Might feel a bit weird. All right. You all right?
So, yeah. Thumbs on his back teeth,
yeah.
Finger under the jaw, yeah. And it's sort of a twisting motion.
Sorry.
Dr. Michael can't get Tom's jaw back in.
When Michael fails, I absolutely know how he's feeling. It's not easy.
Not really getting that.
Oh. 39-year-old Heath is about to have a CT scan after suffering horrific injuries to his leg when his tow truck collided with a semi-trailer.
The number's not good. Makes you wonder that he's bleeding.
Dr. Jonathan and Nurse Sarah are concerned whether or not Heath's stable enough to survive the 10 minutes the scan's going to take.
Got a blood pressure of 85.
Yeah.
So your heart rate's going up, your blood pressure's going down.
Keep pumping the blood in.
Heath's incredibly unstable, primarily because of the blood that he's lost, but also we don't know what else is going on with him. In the pack that I'm carrying with me, I've got approximately 4 units of blood, and I have a feeling that we're going to need every single drop of it.
So we'll keep the fentanyl running, because that'll keep him comfortable, and we've got group and cross-matched blood coming.
We've got blood coming, yeah.
Because it looks like we're going to need it.
Yep.
Yeah. I suspect he's bled a lot more pre-hospital than we thought. And I suspect he's oozing, and that's what this is. We're pumping blood in to restore Heath's blood pressure, but I've only got a limited supply. I know we've got more blood ordered on the way. I don't want to run out in CT. That'd be a disaster. So, Sarah, you're going to take the head?
Yep.
Yep. Do you want to maybe take the leg?
Yeah.
Yeah, and I'll take this leg.
Have you got the oxygen there ready to connect?
Yeah. All right. Let's get across and get an answer.
Just as they're ready to scan, there's a problem.
What's up?
We can only get to above the ankles without the CO2 line being, like, really taut.
Oh, OK.
We checked up the top as well to give it some slack.
What are you saying? You can't scan his feet?
Well, yeah, just because we've got him so far up the table to try and get his toes on.
Okay.
He's huge as well. Yeah. Like, that line's just not going to reach.
I can do the legs, but it won't be an arterial scan.
We need an arterial scan of the legs. Big person.
The technicians have a plan. They'll do two scans. First, Heath's upper body.
The only way it will work is if the monitor is on the table.
And then you'll have more length.
Then his lower body and legs.
Yeah, Abdul.
And we're done. 1, 2, 3. We're good?
That's good.
All right, all the way over on 3. 1, 2, 3.
Finally, Dr. Jonathan can see the full extent of Heath's injuries.
They've given us a good picture, and his chest, as we thought, is OK. His abdomen, I don't see a major bleeding spot, but he might have some bruising in there. And his brain looks OK.
Now, Heath's leg.
Wow, look at that. So that's what we're dealing with. So his leg is sort of hanging on. Really nasty, bad injury. You can see the bones are disrupted there. They're all broken all the way through, and that's how he was trapped in the truck and squashed by the parts of the truck. That's why he was in such agony. Not only can the blood vessel get cut itself and bleed, but the blood vessel can not feed blood to the rest of the body, so it won't feed blood to the foot, which means you can lose your foot if we don't do this properly. Nasty. So when do you think you'll go to theatre?
Planning now, but probably just getting anaesthetics to come down.
Yeah, so not long. Right. Yep. Thank you.
So this is a really catastrophic injury. Lots of muscles and blood vessels and nerves have been damaged in his leg. Even despite having all the experts, the vascular surgeons, the plastic surgeons, he is still at risk of losing his leg. It's just such a nasty injury. He's by no way out of the woods.
Heath's taken to theatre, where surgeons will try to save his leg.
So that split-second moment when his tow truck hit that car has changed his life forever. 1 second changes everything. It's an awful thing to think about, but that's what we see every day.
...17-year-old Tom is having a bad day. One big yawns brought him into the ED, where Dr. Michael is still trying to get his dislocated jaw back into place.
Not really getting anywhere with that.
No, we'll grab Danny.
Okay, grab Danny and go for the... Yeah.
It's clear that both Tom is struggling and Michael's struggling to do it because we've got so much jaw muscle spasm that we're just not overcoming it. So I make the decision for Tom's comfort that we need sedating.
Dr. Steve needs the help of emergency registrar Dr. Daniel Podomo.
Hey, you wanted to sedate this kid with a dislocated jaw. Okay, he's in trauma too. We're waiting for you.
Sorry about that. Just wanted to give it a little try before we have to put you to sleep, okay?
Emergency nurse Liz Wheeler has been checking Tom's medical records and noticed he's been recently seen by a Royal Melbourne cardiologist.
Just to mention as well, he was here about a month ago with looks like a right bundle branch block, so I might do an ECG on him before we do anything.
No problem. Yeah, all good.
Tom needs an ECG because if when we give him the sedation, if he's got any underlying heart problems, then they slow the heart rate down, they lower the blood pressure. It's important to check these things.
So which class did this happen in? Was it math? No. English? Literature? No.
With the ECG all clear, they can begin sedation.
How much do you weigh? 80? How much do you weigh? 70?
74.
74?
Show me with your fingers how much do you weigh. Is that 5? And what's this? 65.
Yeah, 65 kilos. Might feel a little bit cold going up your arm, okay?
50 in?
50. Just try to push it down. You're just trying to overcome the masseter muscles. It's this rotatory movement. You're trying to swing the jaw in.
Whilst you'd think the dislocated jaws are very common, they're not. So people are interested to watch, which absolutely increases the pressure on Michael.
Felt like it went.
Mm. Got it?
Not really getting anywhere with that.
No.
Dr. Michael is still struggling to fix Tom's jaw, which he dislocated just by yawning.
I'm really putting a lot of force through his jaw. I'm trying to essentially move his bones. I'm pretty nervous at this point with all the people looking on and the fact that I've tried already and it hasn't quite worked.
Dr. Michael makes another attempt.
Felt like it went. There we go.
This time, success.
Just check his teeth line up.
Yeah.
But that's the giveaway.
That's okay. You're okay, Jay. You're okay. You're okay. That's it. Well done.
I realise it's work when the jaw it's really a clonk. It's a big movement.
How's your jaw feeling?
Yeah, not too bad.
I feel really relieved and I feel really validated as well. Like, kind of, you know, I've done a good job here. Oh, I'm super relieved because it's so unpleasant to have your jaw like that for 5 hours.
You're just coming around. Don't worry. It's just the drugs. Your jaw's back in now.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
It's all over?
Yeah, it's all over.
Oh, yeah. Just...
No more yawning, though, exactly. So lots of caffeine, keep you awake.
How bad is your pain right now?
I rated it 0 out of 0.
0 out of 0. So you've got no pain at all in your jaw?
Thank you, I do know.
That's wonderful.
My advice to Tom, maybe try and yawn with your mouth closed in the future.
After a quick coffee break, emergency registrar Dr. Andrew Wallace is heading back down to a busy ED.
Hello, anything coming in?
There'll be a hem soon.
Yeah.
Girl is falling off the horse.
Cool. Do you know what trauma bay they'll be in?
His next patient is coming in by chopper from rural Victoria.
She's had a big fall off a horse and she's been in so much pain she's not been able to get up off the ground. This girl could be paralysed.
I've only been forced to go on a horse once. That was a fairly frightening experience.
I know what happens when people get on horses. Absolutely not.
When I was little, I raised to beg my mum and dad for a horse. But I think since working in emergency and just seeing how much damage horses can potentially do, has really put me off.
Air ambulance touches down with 22-year-old Molly, who's suffering extreme pain after being thrown from a horse.
Oh, here they are.
Okay, so collar and pelvis is bound.
The law student and champion rider was training with her horse when she fell.
1, 2, 3.
So this is 22-year-old Molly. So she was riding a horse. We'd gone over a small jump and then the horse's butt. And she said that she was going at sort of cantering slash galloping pace and she's fallen onto a dirt track. She has hit her head. The helmet was essentially undamaged. She had immediate pain to her hip.
Yep.
And she remained lying supine on the ground until the ambulance arrived.
Molly's boyfriend Patrick was filming when the horse threw her.
It all happened really fast. Kind of just jumped the fence and ran in to see if she was all right, and yeah, she was not okay. In a lot of pain, just on her back, on the ground. One leg was kind of up in the air, the other one off to the side, and yeah, couldn't really straighten him out too much just because it hurt so much. So it's just trying to get her as comfortable as possible.
Can you help it? Open your eyes. Pull on my finger. Can I help the vision doing that?
Molly's been riding since she could walk, so she knows the joys of the sport and the risks.
She's fallen quite hard, quite fast, onto probably really tough ground. We know that significant injury to the spine can cause severe pain, and also her pelvis. Pelvic injuries can be life-changing.
Good afternoon. Could I get a mobile pelvic and chest x-ray, please?
That's the pain. Pretty bad?
Yeah.
The passionate rider's been hospitalised 4 times with injuries from the sport, and every time, pain management has been a problem.
Molly's quite sensitive. I think previously morphine and fentanyls caused you a lot of nausea, is that right?
Yeah.
Yeah, and just lots of vomiting?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Then I'd rather just deal with the pain than have it.
Yeah, sure.
To look for any of those major fractures that could be causing her pain, we want to take x-rays of her chest and her pelvis.
That's right, her pelvis. X-rays. Everyone who's not in lead, get out.
All right, Molly, deep breath in. Relax, breathe out.
Looking at the x-rays, I can't see any major fractures, which provides me some reassurance, but not enough that we can't get away without doing a CT scan of her back.
So we're still going for CTs.
Okay, easy.
Thank you.
Molly needs a hard collar to protect her neck in case she has spinal injuries.
How's that feel, lovely? Can you do a big swallow for us? Too restricted? Is that okay?
Dr. Andrew has found a possible alternative to relieve Molly's pain.
Have you ever had endone before?
Yeah.
Was that okay, or did you get the same nausea and vomiting?
That was okay.
That was okay. Okay, maybe we can give you some endone, actually. Like, yeah, it's same, but different to fentanyl, but if you've had it before, then I think that'd be a good idea.
They need the pain medication to kick in before she can go to the scanner.
Hi there, Molly. How are you going?
Yeah, like immense pain in my pelvis, which is the same spot where this same horse has kicked in the past.
Her horse, called Mr. Positive, is a powerful ex-racer she rides whenever she can.
I mean, I still love my horse. It doesn't matter what he does to me, I'm still gonna love him.
If you had to give your pain a score out of 10 at the moment, what do you think it'd be?
10.
A 10. All right, no worries. I might try and get you something a bit stronger than the endone as well, okay? Yeah.
I ask Molly what her pain score is out of 10, and Molly tells me that her pain is a 10, which is concerning because nobody should ever feel like they're in 10 out of 10 pain.
...22-year-old Molly is in agonising pain after being thrown off her horse and hitting the ground hard. Before she can go for a CT scan...
The Nurofen tablets are a little bit bigger than the Endone tablet, OK?
...the team's trying to get on top of her extreme 10 out of 10 pain.
Do you reckon you'll be able to swallow all of those lying down? Yeah? All right. Did you want water or just... Nah. Oh, goodness. You're a trooper. On the count of three, we're rolling all the way across. 1, 2, 3.
She could have sustained a big injury that we can't see with the x-rays. We've got to find out if there's any spinal cord injuries. Until we've got those reassuring CT images, I won't be completely relaxed about it.
With her mum still on the way from the country, it's an anxious time for Molly, waiting to find out if she'll ever ride again.
Mum should nearly be here?
I think so.
Hopefully, yeah. Everything feels better when mum's here, isn't it? At at this moment, with how overwhelmed Molly's feeling, she must just want her mum. Even at 26, when I'm feeling unwell, all I want is my mum. All right, you've got your buzzer, so you'll sing out if you need us.
Thank you.
No worries.
Finally, Dr. Andrew can see what injuries Molly has.
The neck looks good. Let's look at your chest. That all looks good. Hello. Good news, scans looking at your head and your neck or back, they're normal. Just so want to see how you feel. And take the collar off.
Yes, you can go to the toilet.
How does that feel? Just move slightly left and right.
That's fine.
Cool. Just lift your head up off the bed very gently. Okay.
I'm reassured that there's no major injuries and that we've got our pain under control. My suspicion is Molly may have sustained a form of neuropraxia, a temporary injury to the nerve. It's very painful, especially at the very start, but it will improve with time.
Molly can now leave the ED and go to a ward for observation.
With that sort of fall from the horse, Molly's incredibly lucky. And hopefully, excusing the pun, she can get right back up on the horse.
I can't feel legs!
39-year-old Heath suffered horrific injuries when his leg was crushed in the cabin of his tow truck.
So this is a really catastrophic injury. Even despite having all the vascular surgeons, the plastic surgeons, he is still at risk of losing his leg.
Even as he was being wheeled into surgery, there was no guarantee doctors would not have to amputate. After 7 operations, Heath is finally at home with Nicole.
Yeah, mate.
And trusty companion, Tank.
Park it. Thank you. Good boy.
I was pretty drugged up, so I don't think it really hit me straight away. Like, I didn't think it was that bad until the surgeons and that come around and said, like, it would have been easier for him to cut my foot off because it was just sort of hanging there. Then I sort of realised how bad it was.
Heath may need more surgeries and faces a long rehabilitation, but is determined to get back to work.
And I think you're supposed to go on the other side of that.
When Heath says to me that he's going to be back at work by December, that he'll be back in the truck and he's going to be towing, I know that he'll be doing it again. It's what he loves to do. Like, if it makes him happy, it makes me happy.
Oh, I'm probably doing the wrong thing. I'm grateful for everything the Royal Melbourne's done for me. I'm glad that they went above and beyond to keep it. Yeah, they're doing a good job. Amazing job.
22-year-old law student and champion rider Molly was in excruciating 10 out of 10 pain after being thrown off her horse.
I mean, I still love my horse. It doesn't matter what he does to me, I'm still going to love him.
Dr. Andrew was concerned her pain could be a sign of spinal injury.
Until we've got those reassuring CT images, I won't be completely relaxed about it.
After a night in hospital, Molly was given the all clear to go home. Following doctor's orders not to ride for 2 months, Molly was back in the saddle exactly 8 weeks and 1 day later. 17-year-old Tian yawned on his first day back at school and dislocated his jaw.
Has this happened to you before?
No, okay.
Tian needed sedation. Dr. Michael was finally able to get it back into place.
Your jaw's back in now.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
It's all over?
Yeah, it's all over.
Oh, yeah.
He was soon back to school and will certainly be more careful when he yawns in future. 53-year-old John had an accident cycling home from work.
All right, mate. Any pain?
Yeah, my neck.
CT scans revealed a terrifying break in his neck.
He's lucky to be alive and not completely paralysed.
The retail worker didn't need surgery, but wore a neck brace for 4 weeks.
$20 at Aldi, best buy I've ever made, I reckon.
It's been 13 weeks since the father of one's accident.
It's not a day goes past that I don't think, oh, you know, I just think, oh, so lucky, so lucky. I'm just going to do what I can to get myself right. You just want to get on the bike. You just want to get even back to work. I was looking forward to snowboarding this winter and I'm like, okay, I'm not going to do that this year. So what I'll aim next year. I'm feeling really good and just so thankful to everyone. You know, without all the doctors and nurses and surgeons, what they've done for me, yeah, I wouldn't be where I am now.